The prison program you're about to view consists of strong subject matter such as rape, gang fights, stabbings, police corruption, and extortion. Due to the nature and language of the program, viewer discretion is advised.
There are over 2 million inmates in American prisons, state and federal. The stories you're about to hear are from men and women, ex-cons, felons, and convicts who witnessed and survived through rapes, slashings, gang violence, and extortion during their time in America's most dangerous prison systems. Prison X was created to give the viewer a first-person look at prison life during an inmate's most vulnerable time. These are not actors or actresses playing a part. All the stories told are 100% real. We were warned that it could be serious repercussions if these stories are released. Prison X is the evolution of Scared Straight, with stories being told from outside of prison walls.
They call me Raheem Shabazz. I'm Dual Raheem, Captain Calamingas, and my friends call me Dr. Strange. I put in 20 years from 87 to the present. I've been almost every facility on Rikers Island, C-73, C-74, C-76, C-71, C-95, HDM, West Facility, North Facility, OBCC, GRVC. Full building, and then I went through downstate. I've been in Ulster, I've been in Sing Sing, Greenhaven, Attica. I went to Attica with a non-violent 2-4 just because I like to write. Easton, Adirondack, and other facilities I don't even remember right now. Several state bids. One of my numbers, 008-2160, I remember that.
Okay.
My most memorable incident was the gang war that occurred in 89 in Sing Sing, because a brother had got stabbed up real bad. The gang war was over drugs. It wasn't that it was Bloods and Crips or Yethas and like the Kings of 5% or Muslims. It wasn't like that. It was just two drug groups that didn't meet up. You know, they disagreed with each other. And it was a brother that was on my tier, and they was wrapping him up with toilet paper. He was stabbed all up in his body. Yeah. So they was wrapping him with toilet paper as if it was a bandage. And it wasn't holding, he was still leaking. And the main thing with that is, he asked me, he said, "Yo, what do you think?" I said, "Well, just answer this question. If you feel like you're gonna pass out, what you gonna do?" He said, "After I pass out, call for help." I said, "You see what I'm saying? That don't make no sense. You said after you pass out, you're gonna ask for help." So then he lifted up his shirt, called the CO, told everybody get out of the cell, and he went to the infirmary, and then he went to the box for his participation in the riot. But other than that, you know, that was my most trying experience as far as seeing somebody get cut. I mean, you have people who come running down the tier with pieces of steel sticking out their head looking for help. Yeah, they take a metal rod, you know, we got shops and stuff in it. And he got stabbed in the top of his head, and the steel was sticking out the top of his head. He left it in there. They kept telling him to leave the tier, but he didn't want to listen. So he had to learn the hard way. He had to leave with a piece of steel in his brain. As a matter of fact, from 87 through 89, I had filed a complaint that the city was responsible for 90% of the slashings and stabbings on the island because they were supplying the weapons. All of the mops, the brooms, the mop buckets, and the dustpan was made out of steel, so I made them transfer it over into plastic. I became a pain in their neck. They started mentioning me at roll call whenever I would hit their building, because I had a habit of liking paper. I like paper so much. I like to write on it. I like to wipe my ass with it, and I like to sue for it. And if their CEO's name get put on it, well, then that'd be the Calamingas for the day. Thank you. every mop was made out of metal back then. The mop ring and the buckets too, and all of them was broke. And it's a shame that, you know, they was pinning us against each other. What we had to realize was once we came in there, our only sole goal was to go home. Not to gang up and try to oppress the next man, but to get together and make a movement to get up out of there. And that's when I started trying to find out what that law library was about. But my faith was lacking. Once I got back into my faith, studying, I mean, I went to Christian services, Muslim services, Seventh-day Adventist services. I went to every service, even the Father Sin had services at HDM. I went to every service I can go to, right, to learn more about God, to learn more about the faith. And once I was able to put the faith together, then I was able to understand the law books, because the law books is written like the Bible, in parables. And it became more easier when I was able to get my faith back together. I got 16 screws and 2 plates in my face. I was beat up in GRVC by Captain Hernandez and 4 of his boys in the receiving room, which is one of the reasons why I don't want y'all to see my face. I feel like false face. I got one side is bigger than the other. So you just take my word for it. Right now, it's about 15 degrees outside. My face feel like feet. So I just stay like this, and you know who I am. So that's all you need to know. And take kindness for weakness and not to the day. I got beat up because I told the captain that he was wrong for asking me to strip search when I was going to the clinic, and he was under the assumption that I was supposed to be going to court. He didn't like being told he was wrong, so he handcuffed me and took me to the receiving room and stomped the guts out of me. I wound up getting 3 plates in my face, and then they had to cut them out and put 2 plates, and then they sewed them down with 16 screws. Cut my throat open twice. We sued him, we had him fired, and I'm really trying to get rearrested so I can go to jail with him and then give him the same treatment and turn his other cheek. But what we have to understand is the jail system is not really built for what we thought it was built for. It's not really built for crime, because there's really no such thing. If you look at the Ten Commandments, everything that's in the penal law is in the Ten Commandments. So what we're actually doing is committing sins, and the punishment is just too great. First of all, Rikers Island is contaminated. For those of you that don't know, I mean, you, some of us are blessed enough to have our families come and visit us. But did you know that your family is being exposed to methane gas? It's in the computer as well. You can figure it out. It's at buzzle.com. Methane gas exposure symptoms. There's 14 of them. You might even have them. And it's in Rikers Island history. Landfill project, and it's very serious because they pay $1.5 million for anybody who's susceptible to that, but they put gag orders on it.
So they can't speak about it.
Right, but you can get your bread, but you got to sue for it. I worked in the law library after Sing Sing. I learned the law basically in Sing Sing. This guy wanted $75 to do a brief, and he was on his 5th appeal, and I couldn't understand it, so I just asked him what each book represented, and I just read every book in the library and just kept reading. And it was something that I had to do. I wanted to meet my man Drake and OBCC. Mm-hmm. And we linked up real quick on a conspiracy case. He had 80 something co-defendants. We knocked out his kingpin status, and 2 to 3 years we was home. And if they wouldn't have copped to that, they would have beat him straight up on the motions.
Yeah, they gave him kingpin status.
Yeah, they gave him kingpin status.
For sure.
For a conspiracy charge.
Didn't have no names on the paperwork or anything. Oh, that's another thing. This is for all the brothers and sisters. A lot of brothers and sisters getting picked up on these drug charges. They shut the drug labs down in 1996 under the ASCLD. I got a copy of the confidential police report, and I'm going to give you a copy so you can show it on the screen as well. It's in your truck. This ASCLD is called Accreditation State Crime Lab Directive, and the federal government came down and checked in New York to check the labs. Come to find out they was contaminated, the technicians didn't know what they was doing, and a lot of the lab tests, all the lab tests from 96 up were bogus. You got a whole lot of family members doing time for nothing or for fake reports. The five borough district attorneys all agreed to fake these reports. You can tell that the reports are fake because they're missing the chemistry equivalent to the name or method for what you're incarcerated for. Heroin will carry opiates, and there's a marking for opiates that's made by the chemist. For instance, in cocaine, there's a L isomer that's supposed to be marked on the lab report. It's not there. And the duplicative equivalent, which would be the D isomer, is also not there. Which means that the whole lab report is not good, but our brothers is going up state with 4.5 to 9, an incomplete culture to do complete time. So you have to understand that this is very big. This is bigger than small, trust me.
Next time on Prison X.
I'll take it back to when I was in Green in 1988. It's this dude, the Spanish kid. His name is Popeye, you know, he in the dorm. You know, he's what you call a booty band. He like young boys, whatever the case is. So whatever the case is, he do what he do. But I kept warning him, Whatever the case is, that's not tolerated in here. So one morning I'm going to the bathroom, brush my teeth, whatever. And I thought I was like hallucinating or something. I'm hearing moaning and groaning.
This is Prison X.
I said it's Blake Wingate, Abdul Rahim, Raheem Shabazz, Captain Calamagos, or Dr. Strange, whatever you want to call me. And you just witnessed some of my stories for Prison X, you call this?
Mm-hmm.
Prison X, and you stay tuned for the next one, because you'll be able to see how a person like me can get in touch with the president and get a response.